نداء الإسلام.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، indeed all praises is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise him as he deserves to be praised. We ask for his aid and assistance, and we seek for his forgiveness. We seek refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil of our own souls and from the evil of our wicked actions. Whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide, then none can misguide. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguide, then none can guide. I testify that there is none has the right to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alone without any partners. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and messenger to proceed. Brothers and sisters in faith, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us the ability in doing good deeds that could be a mean for attaining his mercy and pleasure. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us tawfiq on loving the knowledge and granting us the ability to continue seeking it to his pleasure, inshaAllah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, alhamdulillah, the Nida'ul Islam Foundation is overwhelmed to have an international speaker from Kuwait, walillahi alhamd.
So, inshaAllah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would like to introduce to you to our Shaykh Hafidhahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Shaykh is an Imam in the Ministry of Endowment in Islamic Affairs in Kuwait, and also he is a preacher in the Shaykh Sabah Al-Salim Al-Sabah Mosque in Al-Aridiyah in Kuwait. And he holds a master's degree in Aqidah. And also, our Shaykh has many mu'allafat or written books. One of the known book of our Shaykh Hafidhahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Asha'ira fi Mizani Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah. So the topic for tonight, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is حقيقة دعوة الشيخ محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله سبحانه وتعالى. The true دعوة of Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab رحمه الله سبحانه وتعالى. Since this is a very big misconceptions and misunderstandings between Muslims, so inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala our Sheikh will shed more light on this topic. Inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-an, I will give the authority to our Shaykh, no other than al-Shaykh Faisal al-Jasim, falyatafaddal ma'ali al-mashkura.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man ihtada bihudah. Ma ba'd, is it clear? Okay. I try to do this lecture in English, even though my English is not perfect, but I try to do my best, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help me in this. The topic is about the life of the Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab and his da'wah. First of all, before we talk about the Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, we have to talk about or speak about the religious situation in the Muslim countries before Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, or at the time that he was born. First of all, we have to know that a lot of the scholars at that time, they wrote many books talking about the religious situation in the Muslim countries, especially in the Arabian Peninsula. One of them is the Sheikh Muhammad al-San'ani. He's a well-known scholar from Yemen, and also Hussein al-Nu'mi also, and other like Qadi Zada in Turkey, and other scholars, they talked about the religious situation in the Muslim country. And there are many people who are يعني, a scholar in history, they talk about this. First of all, if you want to talk about the religious situation, we have to know that the ignorance was spread out most of the Muslim countries. I'm talking about the Sham region. Sham means Syria, Jordan, Palestine, Lebanon, and Egypt region, and Iraq region, and Turkey region, and Yemen region, as well as the Arabian Peninsula. And one of the scholars that he was born or he lived at the time of the Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab da'wah, his name is Hussein ibn Ghannam. He's from the province or the region of Ihsa. He talked about how bad was the religious situation in most of the Muslim countries, in Mecca, in Medina, in Yemen, in Cairo, in Damascus, in Ihsa, in Iraq, in Baghdad, in Istanbul, and other countries. A lot of the graves, they were being worshipped. A lot of manifestation of shirk, polytheism, was spread out in most of the Muslim countries. And Sheikh Muhammad Amir al-Sanani, he has a book. The name of the book is Tathir al-I'tiqad, Purification of the Faith. He talked about how bad was the situation at that time, even in Mecca and Medina. A lot of graves, a lot of buildings were built upon graves, and the people, they are going to these dead people, and they're asking them help, and they're sacrificing for them, and they're making them as intercessors or mediators between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is about the Muslim countries. The Arabian Peninsula was worse than this. Hussein bin Ghannam is the Mu'arrikh, scholar of history. He talked about the village that was Sheikh Hamdulab was born in, which is the village of the city of Al Uyayna. He says there were about 17 trees. They were being to be worshipped and asking barakah from them. And there are many graves, well-known graves of the Sahaba. The people used to travel to them and seeking them and asking them and they're sacrificing to them and seeking help from them, like the grave of Zayd ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. He was in the village of Al-Jubayla, and also in Ghubayra, village of Ghubayra, there were also a grave of Dirar ibn al-Azwar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And even magician, Sahara, they were spread at that time. The people also in the Arabian Peninsula, some of them, they worship caves. And there were a well-known cave, which is Cave of the Princes. The people used to go to that cave and ask that cave help. And they sacrifice and they bring some food for that cave. And there were well-known male palm, the tree of the palm, or palm tree, male one. It's well-known. It's called Fahl al-Fuhul. Any woman who has, if she doesn't get married and she become old, they used to go to that palm tree and they're asking them how a husband. And they used to say, Ya Fahl al-Fuhul, Uridu Zawjan Qabr al-Hawl. Oh, palm, male palm, I ask you a husband before the end of the year. Actually, the Arabian Peninsula at that time, there were some scholars at that time. We're not saying that there were no scholars at that time. But some of the scholars, they have less knowledge. Some of them, they don't have an effort to make da'wah. And some of them, they were influenced by the kings or the rulers of the villages and cities at the Arabian Peninsula. Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab, rahimahullah, He was born at the year of 1115 in the city of Al-Uyayna. He was raised up in a well-known family. His father was a well-known scholar. His grandfather was he was a well-known scholar, even though some people say that he was the most knowledgeable scholar at that time. He died before Sheikh Al-Rahab was born. Anyway, he was raised at that family with the scholar, with the ilm, knowledge, and also his father. He gained knowledge from his father, especially that his father was the judge of the city of Al-Uyayna. And you know, the judge, the people used to come to him, to them, and they discussed, and even the students of knowledge, they used to come to him. And some scholars from other cities, when they come to Uyayna, they used to come to him. So his house usually gathered many scholars. So Sheikh Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, he got benefit from that house, and he gained knowledge. Even he traveled to Al-Qasim to gain knowledge from some scholars at Al-Qasim. Sheikh Muhammad Wahhab, rahimahullah, he was influenced a lot from the books of Sheikh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and his students Ibn Al-Qayyim. And he used, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gained him some knowledge and some dhaka. He was clever, smart. And when he was reading about in the books of al-ilm, like explanation of the hadith and the books of tafsir and the books of the scholars, he says, okay, what is written in the books is different than what I see outside. So the people, the ulama says that there is no one to worth to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the worship is the humiliation of and submission with veneration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means you have to obey him in all matters that he ordered us to do, like sacrificing, making, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, vow and pray and all kind of worship, even the worship in the heart or worship in the body or by statements. So he says, he sees the people are, they have been away from real Islam. He used to talk with his father about what he knows and what he read in the books. And his father, he used to tell him that what are you saying is correct, but the people there got used to these things and we try to help them. But these things or this kind of shirk or polytheism, and they used to take it from their fathers and grandfathers. It's the society influencing them. Anyway, Sheikh Abdul Wahhab used to talk about this with all the people that he sit with the scholars, students of knowledge, and the general people. He asked his father to go to Hajj when he was 18 years old. He went to Mecca. And you know, Mecca and Medina used to gather many scholars, a lot of scholars from Sham, from Syria, from Egypt. They used to come to make Umrah or make Hajj and to visit the Medina Nabawiyyah, Medina Munawwara. So a lot of them, they sit for months. So it's a place where you find many scholars of Islam at that place. He got benefit from this. And he sat with the scholars. He gained a lot of knowledge. That it wasn't many knowledge like in Arabic and Arabic language and other usul, foundation of fiqh and hadith also. So he met a lot of scholars. Then he stayed for 3 months. Then he went to Medina. At Medina, Medina Munawwara, he met two of the scholars. They had great or big impact on Sheikh Muhammad Al-Wahhab Rahimahullah. The first one, his name is Abdullah Ibrahim ibn Saif al-Najdi. He is a scholar from Najd, but he was born in Medina. His father from Najd actually, but he left Najd and he sat in Medina. And And the other scholar is Muhammad Hayat al-Sindi. He is well-known, a scholar in Hadith, from Ahl al-Hadith, the people of Ahl al-Hadith. He was influenced and affected by them a lot. And both of them, they are following the correct faith, the correct aqidah, and they're following the sunnah. They try to follow the sunnah perfectly. And the Sheikh Abdullah Ibrahim Saif al-Najdi, he has many books of Sheikh Salam al-Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim. So he stayed at Medina, he stayed in Medina for around 6 months or more. He gained a lot of knowledge, and also he met some of the main scholars, like Muhammad al-Sattarini. He's well known in Hanbali Madhab, and Abil Mawahib, and Ali al-Daghestani, Zaki al-Daghestani. They are well known scholars from Sham. He met them at Medina. Then he went back to Al-Uyayna with a great knowledge, and he knows now that he has to make jihad to spread the knowledge and to purify the aqidah, the faith of the Muslims or the general people at the Arabian Peninsula. He tried, when he came back to Uyayna, he tried to spread his da'wah, but he was under 20 years old. So the people say, okay, he's young and he's, they don't care about what he says. Then he stayed for some months. Then he told his father that he wants to gain more knowledge and he wants to travel to seek more knowledge. And his father allowed for him to go to Al-Iraq through Al-Ihsa. He went to Al-Ihsa. Then he traveled to Al-Iraq. And Iraq at that time, it was under the ruling of the Ottoman Empire. But the Arabian Peninsula and Al-Ihsa on the shore, it wasn't under the rule of the Ottoman Empire. Somebody might say, why? Ottoman Empire is a great Muslim country and a big Muslim country. Actually, the Ihsa, the people of the tribe of Bani Khalid, they took over that land from them. But the Arabian Peninsula, especially the Najd region or Najd province, it was cities and it was deserts. So the Ottoman Empire, they don't have any interest to go to the desert where there were no water, nothing. They used to care about the Mecca and Medina and the seas, the shores. But within the Arabian Peninsula, the desert land, they don't care about. So all the Najd province, there are a lot of cities. Every city, they have a ruler or what they call a prince or emir. And there are many of them. Anyway, he went to Iraq and he met some scholars of Iraq like Muhammad al-Majmu'i, Hussein al-Islambuli, Umar Agha and others, or al-Mosuli Aydan, also one of the scholars. When he went to Iraq, some of the tujar, what do you call it, tajir? The tajir, people who make trading, trader from Najd, he saw him. And he also heard about his da'wah, that he came to the people and he told them, okay, don't ask the dead people, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the only one who were to be worshipped and others. So he went to Iraq. Even though, you know, Iraq, especially in Basra, he went to Basra. Al-Basra have many Shia. Shia, they worship graves and dead people like Ali or Hussein radiallahu ta'ala. And he told them, okay, you have one student of knowledge from Najd, and he will come to you. He'll say, this is kind of shirk, and asking dead people and righteous people is kind of shirk. You have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he tried to convince them to kick out the sheikh from Al-Basra. The people of Basra, they went to the ruler of the Basra. As I told you, the Basra was under the ruling of the Ottoman Empire. He went to the ruler and he said, okay, we have a student of knowledge from Najd. We don't want him. He comes with a new faith. He comes with a new madhab. He hates the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, this is the rumors where they used to spread about Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab da'wah. The ruler brought Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab, and he was about 24 years old or 23 years old. And he told him, the people say this and this about you, and you have a new madhab, and you hate the Prophet, and you are from the Khawarij, you making takfir of the Muslims, you are saying that they are kuffar, they are not non-Muslims. After he finished, Sheikh Al-Rahab asked him, can I speak now? Can I refute this? He said, okay, go ahead. When he speaks, he brings the evidences from the Quran and Sunnah and the statements of the scholars and the four Imams, Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed. And he was surprised about this student of knowledge. He was young with this type of knowledge. And he knew that what they say about him is a rumor and it's not true. So he told them, okay, Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab, you don't sit at the place that you're in now. You have to be in the major city. And we have to make a big class for you so the people can benefit from it. And alhamdulillah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ruler made the big class for the Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab. And he was teaching at that class. Even the judge of the Basra, he used to come. And the ruler of the Basra, he used to come to Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab classes, even though he was under 25 years old. After that, the ruler was changed. After some months or 1 year or 1 year and a half. So the people also went to the new ruler and they said the same thing. So the ruler also brought Sheikh Muhammad al-Wahhab in his place, and he told them that the people say this about you. And also he refuted all what they said, and he was also influenced. He was surprised about this student of knowledge. And he says, okay, you have to teach. We have to make a school for you so you can teach him. The people of Basra, after this, they said, okay, the only way for us to kick him out is to try to kill him. And they tried to kill him. They told him, either you leave Basra or we'll kill you. So he left the Basra and he went back to Al-Uyayna. This was about the years 1139 of Hijra al-Nabawiyyah. When Sheikh came back, his father was the judge of the city of Uyayna. A new ruler of the city of Uyayna comes and he has some conflict with his father. So his father left Al-Uyayna and he went to another city, which is the city of Hreimla or the village of Hreimla. So the sheikh came to his father. And through his way, also he went to Al-Ihsa and he met some scholars, Abdullah ibn Abdul Latif. And the Sheikh Abdullah bin Fayrouz is the father of the one with the biggest enemy of Sheikh. Not him. His son was, he will become one of the enemies of the Sheikh, of Da'wah of the Sheikh. So then he went to Hreimla and he sat with his father. And at that time, he wrote his major book, which is the Book of At-Tawheed. Kitab At-Tawheed, the Book of At-Tawheed, or the Book of the Monotheism of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After he wrote his book, he wants this book to be a book of his da'wah. Somebody asked him about his da'wah. He says, okay, my da'wah is called about what I wrote in this book. He sent this book also to his scholars in the Sham and the Medina to make sure that he didn't make any mistake. And they wrote to him that this book is a great book and what you wrote, we agree about it. So the Sheikh al-Wahhab used to write at that time. Because the city, Hreimla, is not their city. They are foreigners at that time. So he used to write to the scholars to refute some doubts about Tawheed, about what he calls. After that, his father died at the year 1153. Then a new ruler came to, he became a ruler of Al-Uyayna. So he came to the Sheikh al-Wahhab and he told them, okay, you have to come back to your city. The city that you were born in, and I support you and support with da'wah, your da'wah. Sheikh al-Wahhab, rahimahullah, he traveled also to the city of Uyayna. He became the judge of that city, and he made a lot of classes in tafsir, in hadith, in fiqh, in foundation, usul, in lugha al-arabiya language, or Arabic language. And the people used to come to him, student knowledge from all over Najd province, they used to come to him. So he spread his da'wah. And he wrote to many of the people and many of the scholars. He wrote to the kings, to the rulers, to the princes. The prince, they were ruling the Najd province or cities of Najd. At that time, two things happened. The first one, after Sheikh Abdul Wahhab, he convinced now that his da'wah is spread. His da'wah mainly concentrating of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, polytheism. Concentrating or calling the people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to leave all polytheism. To leave all types of polytheism. Don't ask dead people. Don't ask angels. Don't ask anybody. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All type of worship, like salah, siyam, dua, like nadhr, vowing, sacrificing, it has to be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the meaning of la ilaha illallah. There's no one to be worth to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the worship is a big name. It has worship in the heart, like tawakkul Allah Azza wa Jal, khawf, fearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, raja, and worship in the body, like salah, like sacrificing and vowing, and also the kind of worship is statements like takbir, tasbih, la ilaha illallah, subhanallah, the statement that we say in the salah and hajj, and all type of worship that we do it by our tongue. So this is the main concept or the main things or pillar of Sheikh Abdul Wahhab da'wah. He's asking people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wants to purify Islam. Sheikh Abdul Wahhab, now we're talking about now the year is about 1156 or 55 of the Hijrah. That means that his da'wah is about more than 30 years old. And he spread the knowledge in all over the places. He told the prince of the ruler of Uyayna, his name is Uthman ibn Ammar. He says, now we have to make actions and to make jihad, to correct all the situations, the bad situations, or type of shirk, or type of polytheism. We have to remove it from our country. Or our land. So he went to the main grave at that time in Najd province, which is the grave of Zayd ibn Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala. He went with an army, and he the grave they were building a house on top of it. So he removed the house, he raised the grave as a shibr, the same as the Prophet Muhammad told us to do. So he make his grave the same as all the Muslim graves. He removed all type of buildings, type of stones on top of it. This thing was a shock in the whole Arabian Peninsula. The other thing that one of the ladies or women, she made zina, committed zina, and she was married. And she asked Sheikh Abdul Wahhab to make rajm, to make had on her. And he left her. She came four times. And she made iqrar. She said, okay, I made a zina, I committed the zina. I need you to purify me with the had, with making rajm. So she came four times. And after that, Sheikh Abdul Wahhab, even because of he is the judge, and he made the Muslims stoned her to death. And this was also another shock, something that made big shock in the Arabian Peninsula. Why? Because most of the rulers at that time in the Arabian Peninsula, they're not following the correct Islam, and they're ruling with their ruling from not from the Quran and Sunnah. And they said, okay, this judge and this city is coming with the rule of Islam, and this will spoil all of what we do. And they come to us and they might refute our actions, and they يعني might make jihad to us. So a lot of bad scholars that they hated what the Sheikh Hanab came up with, because a lot of them, they said, okay, they يعني conflict the da'wah of Sheikh Hanab, not because he didn't come with something true, because the people blamed them. They said, okay, if Hamdul Wahab, what he says is wrong, and our action our actions before, which is asking the dead people, sacrifice to dead people, going to the trees, to seeking barakah from them, if this is shirk, as what he says, why you don't يعني, warn us about this before? Why you left us doing action of shirk? If he says is correct. So because they don't want the people to blame them, they refuted the da'wah of Sheikh Hamdul Wahab, rahimahullah, and they tried to write to the rulers to make يعني, to try to influence or to write to يعني, fight Al-Uyayna, and also make some tahdeed. I don't know what to tahdeed, يعني, they warn the ruler of Uyayna. And one of the big ruler at that time, or the strongest ruler at that time, he is the ruler of Al-Ihsa. Ihsa is a big province. It's on the sea, it's very rich, very strong. And he wrote a letter to the ruler of Uyayna. His name is Uthman Muammar. He says, if you don't kick this man from your city, otherwise I will stop you and the people from you to come to Al-Ihsa. That means this is kind of sanction. This kind of sanction on also another one of the major tribe at that time, he wrote to the ruler of Uyayna, Uthman Muammar, and he told them, if you don't kick Muhammad al-Wahhab out of your city, otherwise I will fight you with all my tribe. This is one of the greatest, biggest tribe at that time at the Arabian Peninsula. Uthman al-Ammar, he couldn't stand this tahdidat, and he told Sheikh Hamdul Wahab, okay, I cannot stand anymore. Please leave us until everything calm down. Sheikh Hamdul Wahab tried to convince him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will support you, and you have to have patience, and what I call for is the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this da'wah of the Prophet Muhammad sallam, and Allah will support you and the victory will come to you, but you have to be patient. He says, okay, I cannot stand anymore, you have to go out from Uyayna. Sheikh Hamdul Wahab left Uyayna and he doesn't know where to go. Then after he left alone, he remembered that he has some students of knowledge. He's from Al-Dir'iyya. Dir'iyya is a small village. If you compare it with Uyayna, it's very small compared to Uyayna. Uyayna is big. He went to Uyayna, Dir'iyya, and he went to Dir'iyya because the ruler of the Dir'iyya has some conflict with the ruler of Ihsa. So he thinks that if we go, is it clear or not? Do you hear me? You hear me, huh?
No, Masmud. I can hear you.
Alhamdulillah. Okay. So he went to Uyayna, to Dir'iyya, and he went to his student's house, and the son of the ruler of Uyayna, of Dir'iyya, he was a student of knowledge, and he met Sheikh Hamdul Wahab in Uyayna, and he was affected about his da'wah. So they went to the ruler of Dir'iyya, and they said, you have to support this ruler, Hamdul Wahab, rahimahullah, and you have to support him, and he is calling to Islam, and he is following the Prophet, and he is calling for Tawheed, purifying Islam, purifying the faith of the people, asking people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, not to worship others than him, none graves, none angels, none ghosts, none anything. So the ruler of Dir'iyya went to the house that Hamdul Wahab was sitting or was staying at, and he told them, okay, I will support you. Don't worry about all the warnings that came to you, and I will support you, and you are in a safe place. Then Muhammad Wahab, he made bay'ah with him, and he says, believe me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you the ruler of the whole Arabian Peninsula if you support and if you يعني, be patient supporting the da'wah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was at the year of 1159 of the Hijrah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After that, the cities surrounding the Dir'iyya, they couldn't stand this situation. So they tried to fight Dir'iyya. And the fighting started from that time up until the time of the death of the Muhammad Rahab rahimahullah. He died at 1206 of the Hijrah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the time that the time of the death of the Muhammad Sheikh Muhammad Rahab rahimahullah, the city of Dir'iyya, the houses at the city at the beginning was 70 houses only. Imagine this city village. The houses is the count of the houses are 70 houses only. At the time that Sheikh Al-Rahab died, it owns the most about 70% of the whole Arabian Peninsula. All the da'wah spread all over the Arabian Peninsula. And still continue. They also they took Mecca and Medina and a lot part of Yemen and Oman and Imarat and all these places. Even their troops or army, they reached Damascus. They came very close to Al-Basra. So they ruled all this area. And this is what the Sheikh Al-Wahhab told Muhammad bin Saud. He was the ruler of Dir'iyya, that if you support this da'wah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you the ruler of the whole Arabian Peninsula. This is in a brief the history of the Shaykh Muhammad Wahhab rahimahullah. And I want to talk about the pillars or the main pillars or the main foundation of Shaykh Muhammad Wahhab da'wah. The first foundation is Tawheed. Polytheism. He's calling to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's calling he's spreading the correct meaning of La ilaha illallah. No one worth to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And worship is humiliation and submission with veneration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by obeying Him. This is the main pillar or main foundation of his da'wah. So he's fighting all type of shirk, all type of polytheism, like asking dead people, sacrifice for dead people, asking angels, making vowing to them, asking them, seeking help from them, asking absent or sick people, and all type of shirk. The second thing is to purify the second pillar of shahada. Shahada, ashhadu an la ilaha وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. لا إله إلا الله means the polytheism of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Worshiping Allah سبحانه وتعالى alone and leaving all kind of worship to other than Allah سبحانه وتعالى. The second pillar of shahada is the following of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He is asking the people to perfectly following the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in all of what he obeyed or what he obligated on us and asked us to do. The third thing is that he's calling for the unity of the Muslims. And he's saying the unity of the Muslims cannot be reached except on the Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa Ashhadu anna. If the people of the Muslims comply and fulfill these kind of things, worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and leaving all type of shirk, and following the Prophet perfectly and correctly, and they don't bring any statement of any scholars instead in front of the Prophet ﷺ statements, the Islam can unite on these type of things. Purifying the Tawheed and purifying the following of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. So this is the unity. The fourth pillar of foundation of his da'wah is to respect the scholars and to gain knowledge from the scholars, but we cannot make the statement of the scholars the same as the statement of the Prophet Muhammad. Follow any type method. You can be a Shafi'i, you can be a Hanbali, you can be Maliki. But if you find the evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah, like the Prophet hadith, you have to follow the hadith, the Quran and Sunnah. You cannot say, okay, this is Shafi'i said this. Nobody, no one can be in front of the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the statement of the Prophet with respect of the ulama. And we have to know that all what they say, if they have some statement which is, doesn't fulfill or does, there are some hadith contradict their statements, we know that they have excuses. The hadith might not reach them, or the hadith might reach them, but in a weak narrations or other type of excuses. But the main thing that we have to respect the ulama, we have to follow them, to respect them, to gain knowledge from them, but we don't put their statement in the front of the statement of Quran and Sunnah. The fifth foundation or pillar of his da'wah is to spread knowledge. All type of shirk, all type of innovations, bid'ah, that was spread in all over the Muslim countries was because of the ignorance. The ignorance is the biggest disease of all Muslim society. The Muslim society cannot follow the way of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the way of his Prophet Muhammad sallam, except the knowledge is spread all over the Muslim society. So he says, if we want to be perfect, to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we want to gain victory, if we want to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to gain the, fuz with the Jannah, and we go away from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want victory, if you want izzah, we have to follow, we have to spread knowledge in all over our society. So because of this, he made many classes in all types of ilm. He spread knowledge, and we have to make da'wah. You don't have to make to gain knowledge alone. You have to make da'wah. You have to ask to act upon the knowledge that you know. You have to ask the people to follow the knowledge, the correct knowledge, which is the correct knowledge based on the Quran and the Sunnah and the following of the companions. Three things: following Quran, following Sunnah, and understanding Quran and Sunnah with the understanding of the companions. Al-ilm, qala Allah, qala Rasul, qala Sahaba. This is the knowledge. The knowledge is what Allah says, what the Prophet Muhammad says, what the Sahaba says. This is the knowledge. So we have to call up to call the people to this type, to this path. This is the correct path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also to be patient. As long as you're making da'wah, you're following the Prophet Muhammad, you will have enemies. If you have enemies, they will try to refute you, they try to stop you from da'wah. You have to be patient in order to spread the da'wah. So, nashr al-ilm, spreading knowledge, calling the people according to this knowledge, and to be patient. The sixth thing is to making jihad. If we establish the correct Muslim country, we have to remove all types, all kind of shirk, all innovations in the society, and we have to call other countries to follow the correct path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to follow the tawheed and the sunnah. We have to follow polytheism, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and we have to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to follow Quran and Sunnah and understand them upon the understanding of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope what I said is clear. My English is not perfect, but inshallah, if there are some questions or some any comments, I can hear from you and answer you, inshallah. بارك الله فيك والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله
الحمد لله رب العالمين
We have listened to our Shaykh Hafidhahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have gained many knowledge, and alhamdulillah, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this knowledge may be the solution for us to get away from the misconceptions and misunderstanding about the da'wah of the of Shaykh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have understand from the lecture of our Shaykh, alhamdulillah, it's been clarified that the Shaykh, the Imam, the Mujaddid is oppressed. It comes to the reality that his da'wah, upon his da'wah, he was oppressed by his own people. Naam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant victory to those who are steadfast in his religion. Walillahi alhamd. And we have also learned that the da'wah of Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, that he warned the people against shirk, bid'ah, and sins, purifying them by strictly holding to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Quran, and being steadfast to the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and comprehending the deen according to the understanding of the Salaful Ummah. And also we have understand the main foundation of the da'wah of Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First is At-Tawheed, the monotheism, and this is the very important main foundation of the da'wah of every Muslim. And also the Ittiba'u Sunnah, following the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Maybe there will be no more question and answer. Is there? Maybe there's do you have questions? We haven't gained questions from the audience here, Sheikh.
If you don't, I want to clarify some topics.
Challenge.
There's time. Okay.
About the term Wahhabism, Sheikhana, where did this term started? And Anam, that is the question, Sheikh.
First of all, Wahhabism, this term was, it wasn't at the time of the Sheikh Muhammad Wahhab da'wah. Came after this with a short time. And they tried to make this term to yunaffir an da'wah. That means making the people be away. They want to people to think that he comes with a new religion. He's not, what he calls for is not Islam. Something which is Wahhabism, which is a religion based on his thinking. This is what they meant by a Wahhabiyya. First of all, well, I have to mention that one of the main conflict or ikhtilaf difference between him and some of the scholars at that time, even though there were few at the Arabian Peninsula, is ta'rif al-shirk. What is shirk? What is polytheism? They claimed that when you're asking dead people, when you are sacrificing for them, when you are asking help from them, asking them to purify you or to anything, asking from them, this is not the type of shirk until you think that they own harm and benefit. But if you come to a dead man and you say, okay, oh, forgive me, or oh, help me, or oh, give me health, or oh, cure me from this disease, or whatsoever, as long, they say, this is, as long as you don't believe that he has or he owns harm and benefit, this is not kind of type of shirk. The shirk only, if you believe that this dead or righteous man, he owns harm and benefit with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one of the main difference between his da'wah and the what the people say to him at that time. What they claim, a shirk, or what they claim that this is the shirk, it has to be to believe in the people or the dead people that they harm or they owns harm and benefit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarified this in the Quran. And he says, the mushrikeen at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, they used to say, oh, what we worship, even though grave, righteous people, angels, they don't own anything. They don't own benefit, no harm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated clearly that they worship them as a mediators, that as intercessors between them and Allah. They said, we cannot reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. We have to go through these mediators. So we worship them, we sacrifice for them, so they make us close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in the Quran, that this is type of shirk at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallam, the shirk of Quraysh. And this is the same statements of the people of Arabia Peninsula at that time. They were stating, they were saying this to Shaykh Muhammad Rahab rahimahullah. So the shirk is not that you believe in the dead people when you're asking them, that you believe that they own harm and benefit. No. As long as you worship them with sacrificing or asking them or seeking anything, any help from them, even though you believe that they are only mediators, they are only intercessors, this is the shirk which is written in the Quran. So the most of the people at that time, they don't understand shirk. They think shirk is only in the belief, not in the actions. And he said, no, shirk is to worship Allah. Worship Allah. There's no difference between two people. One of them, he worshiping the dead people, and he believes that they own benefit and harm. And the other one, he's worshiping dead people, and he thinks that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only owns harm and benefit. No difference between them. All of them, they are worshiping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the shirk in ibadah, in worshiping, is to worship other than Allah. And despite of your belief in the one that you are worshiping. So this is one of the main topics about or main difference between meaning of shirk that Shaykh Hanuhab came up with, which is the shirk is in the Quran and the Sunnah, and the people what the people think about. This one thing. Another thing, I want to show you something. Now, Shaykh Muhammad al-Wahhab, rahimahullah, the people says, okay, they spread about him, they spread out a lot of rumors about him. He hates the Prophet ﷺ. He doesn't respect the scholars. He came up with a new religion. He is making takfir of the Muslims. He says, any Muslims, he's kafir. Anybody who doesn't follow him, he's kafir. All the people have to travel to him and to seeking knowledge from him, otherwise they are kuffar. Oh, a lot of rumors. So we tell them, Shaykh Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, he wrote a lot of books. He wrote 11 volumes. This is the first volume, volume number one. This is volume number 11. So we have 11 volumes of knowledge of his writing, of his books that he authored and he published and he wrote. So go to these 11 volumes and please come up with anything in his book which contradicts Quran and Sunnah. Come up with any innovations. Come up with any statements that he stated this alone. Nobody came up with this kind of statements. All of what is in his volumes or in his books are the same as in other books of the scholars of Islam, like Imam Ahmad, Shafi'i, Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, and other scholars of Islam, Al-Layth, Al-Awza'i. He didn't bring anybody who says he came up with a new idea or a new ruling. Please tell them to bring this. Where? Please يعني state, he said this in this volume and this. The people are spreading rumors, lying. They said, he says this. He says he hates the Prophet ﷺ. He's saying the people are kuffar. Wait. Now we have 11 volumes of his books. Please go through these volumes. If you find anything which is not according to the Quran and Sunnah and not fulfilling or following the Prophet or the scholars of Islam, the great scholars, show us. They all his enemies, they don't go to his books, even though that he has 11 volumes of books that he published or he wrote. They don't go. They come up with the lies. This book says this, another book. Somebody says this, somebody says this. No, no, no. Go to what he wrote. This is clarify his da'wah. So I hope, inshallah, this is clear, inshallah. Allah.
Inshallah,
Shaykh. Naam.
Alhamdulillah, we have received some questions here, Shaykhana. First question is, can we use the term Wahhabi to ourselves as a follower of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah and from the teachings of Quran and Sunnah and the teachings of Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab? Can we call ourselves as Wahhabi or should we be proud of it like that, Sheikh?
No. Wahhabi, Shaykh al-Salam, Shaykh Muhammad al-Wahhab, rahimahullah, he's Salaf. He's following the path of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. So he's not Wahhabi, because Wahhabi, they meant by Wahhabi a new religion, a new madhab. He doesn't have a new madhab. He says, I am Hanbali. He says, I am following Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. But if I see the Quran Sunnah, I cannot bring the statement of Imam Ahmad in front of the Quran. I follow his way. I'm from one of his followers, even though I follow the Quran and Sunnah. When I see the Quran and Sunnah is not fulfilled or not comply with the statement or some statement of Imam Ahmad. So we don't say we are Wahhabi. We say we are Muslims. We are Salafi. We are from following of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah methodology. This is the way. But Wahhabi, the meaning of it, which is in the media and others, a new religion. We are not Wahhabi. We are Salafi. We are fulfilling or following the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, following the methodology of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah.
Another question, Sheikh. Did Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab made takfir of the Muslims?
He's calling for Islam. How he makes takfir of Muslims? He's calling to the perfect Islam. So he's purifying Islam. He's asking the people to go back to the understanding of the companions. He's calling them to go back to the meaning of Quran, to follow the scholars of Islam, to follow Imam Ahmed, to follow Imam Shafi'i, to follow Imam Malik, to follow Imam Abu Hanifa, to follow Al-Layth, Al-Awza'i, Makhul, Al-Zuhri, Ata, and the companions, Ibn Abbas, Ibn Umar. He's calling the people to follow them, not to follow him. So he's calling to Islam, and he doesn't make any takfir of Muslims, but he makes takfir of mushrik. If somebody comes to dead people, dead man, even if he's righteous, even if he goes to the grave of the Prophet Muhammad Sallam, or some graves of the Sahaba, companions, or he's asking angels or righteous people, if he go, okay, he asks absent people or dead people, this is kind of shirk. He's not Muslim. This man is not Muslim. He's not Muslim in Quran, not Muslim in Sunnah. And this is a jama' of ulama that anybody who asks dead people any type of asking, he's mushrik. He's not Muslim. These are the people that he says they are not Muslims. But the people of shirk, or the people, they don't understand what is shirk. They think they are Muslims. When he comes to say, okay, they are mushrikeen because they're worshipping Allah, worshipping other than Allah, they're worshipping dead people. How they are worshipping them? They're sacrificing for dead people. They're asking dead people. They're seeking help from dead people. And this is shirk. So they are mushrikeen. And they think that this is not shirk and they are Muslims. They say, okay, he's making takfir Muslims. He's not making takfir Muslims. He's making takfir of mushrikeen. لايك الشيعة اليوم. الشيعة اليوم they're worshiping علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه. They're worshiping الحسين. They go to the grave of علي in the Najaf and the grave of الحسين in كربلا and they're making طواف on their graves. They're saying يا علي يا حسين. Oh حسين help us. Oh علي help us. This is kind of shirk. So are they Muslim? Are they Muslims? They're not Muslims. So if somebody says, okay, you are not Muslims because you're worshiping other than Allah, you're worshiping Ali, you're worshiping Al-Hussein radiallahu anhu, Allah says there's no one to worship except Allah, and this type of worshiping, and you are worshiping other than Allah, somebody says, okay, you're making takfir Muslims because you're saying these people who are asking, worshiping Ali, they are mushrikeen. Can you say that he's making takfir Muslims? You say no. He's making takfir of mushrik, not the Muslims. He doesn't come to anyone is upon the tawheed, upon the polytheism, and he says this is mushrik. He only says mushrik to one who is committing shirk in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Now, another question, Sheikh. This is from the shubahat of the mubtadi'een. Did the Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab made Khuruj under the Ottoman Empire?
The answer is, as I told you, Arabian Peninsula is a desert. It's a desert. No trees, no water, nothing. There's no interest for the Ottoman Empire to go through these deserts. All the Arabian Peninsula, many villages, hundreds of villages and cities, every village has a ruler. So you'll have the province of Najd, which is one province of Arabian Peninsula. Arabian Peninsula has many provinces. One of this district or province is Najd. It has tens of villages, more than 100 villages. Each village has a ruler by himself from the own people. And all the people, all the scholars of history, nobody says whatsoever that Arabian Peninsula, the district of Najd, the province of Najd, was under the ruling of the Ottoman Empire, because Ottoman Empire, they don't care about this. The Ihsa district, which is very rich and very important, and it is on the sea, it wasn't under the ruling of Ottoman Empire because it was under the ruling of the Bani Khalid, the tribe of Bani Khalid. So the Ihsa wasn't under the ruling of the Ottoman Empire, and even though that Ihsa is very rich and very important, and it was before this, it was under their ruling, but at the time of at the year of 1080, the tribe of Bani Khalid took over this province or this district, which is Ihsa. How about Najd, which is desert? So even the scholars or the muarrikhin, the people of history, in Ottoman Empire, they didn't state that the Najd is under the ruling of the Ottoman Empire. So in Uyayna was a ruler, in Hremla was a ruler, and in Dir'iya was a ruler. In Uyayna, a ruler Uthman Ammar, and Dir'iya Muhammad bin Saud. So he was under many rulers. So when Dir'iya fights other cities, they fight another ruler. So Khuruj means that you're under the ruling of your imam, your king, your sultan, and you're under his bay'ah, then you make Khuruj of him. Like I'm from Kuwait, we have rule, we have prince. When I make Khuruj, because I'm under his ruling, this is Khuruj. But another city, let's say, okay, we have Bahrain, and they have some differences or conflict with Kuwait, and they fight each other. We don't say Bahrain is making khuruj of Kuwait or Kuwait is making khuruj, because this is a separate country and this is a separate country. So each village in Najd is a separate village with a separate ruler by himself. And they were fighting each other before Da'wah Uthman bin Wahhab and after this. So anybody who says he made khuruj of Uthmaniyya, he doesn't know anything about history.
Now, another question, Sheikh. Is Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab the only one to establish Islam to correct the real Aqidah or any other ulama in his time?
Yeah, at his time, as I told you, There are many scholars of his time. Qadi Zada, he's one of the main scholars. And Al-Birqawi, also his sheikh, was in Turkey before Shah Ibn Wahhab, about 100 years before, or 8 years before. But they didn't have any support. They made for Islam, they made for, they called for Tawheed, for يعني perfecting, following the Prophet Muhammad Sallam, fulfilling the Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, purifying the Tawheed and the faith. But nobody supported them. Muhammad Amir Sanani in Yemen, Hussein al-Nu'mi in Yemen, al-Jabarti in Egypt, other scholars in India, Muhammad Hat al-Sindi, as I told you, his sheikh, Muhammad Hat al-Sindi, in Medina, Abdullah ibn Saif al-Najdi, in Medina, Muhammad al-Safarini, one of the Hanbali Madhab, is in al-Sham, Ismail al-Jura'i, one of the major Hanbali scholars in al-Sham. All of them, they're following the Sunnah, following the Tawheed, but nobody supported them. The main thing, why that Abdul Wahhab was spread? Because he was supported by the ruler. As Sheikh Samtamiya says, the Islam cannot be established perfectly except with two things. Kitabun Yahdi wa Sayfun Yansur. A book which guides the people and the sword of the ruler. This is the main thing. Sheikh Samtamiya, he was calling to his da'wah, which is the same da'wah of Sheikh Ibn Wahhab, but nobody supported him. He was jailed. He was put in jail 7 times, even though he died in the jail. But Sheikh Ibn Wahhab, the main thing that a ruler supported him with the sword, because of this, his da'wah has big influence, big impact on all the Muslim countries, because it was supported by the sword or by the rulers. No.
Another question, Sheikh. Did Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab made the ruling haram on Tafweed?
Tafweed, you mean in names of attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
لا أدري يا شيخ. I don't really understand the question. About Tafweed.
If he means that Tafweed, that we say that the names of attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we believe in them, but we don't understand the meaning. Ar-Rahman Arsh Sawa, we don't understand what does this mean. Inna Allah yuhibbu tawabin, Allah loves tawabin. We don't understand what this means. If he meant this type of tafweed is bid'ah. And all Ahl Sunnah Jama'ah says this type of tafweed is bid'ah, because the meaning of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is known by the Arabic language, by the statements of the companions and the their followers and their followers. So tafweed is bid'ah. He's not saying this is bid'ah, not him alone, all the scholars, because this tafweed means that we recite Quran and we don't understand it. It's like you're reciting or reading some Chinese books, even though that you don't know Chinese language. No.
Maybe this is the last question, Sheikh, and it's not about the topic, but now it is about Aqidah. Do Asha'ira and Maturidiya is from the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah?
Al-Masha'ira and Al-Maturidiya, they are two sects, two groups or sects. They are not following the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, because they have big differences. There are major differences between them and the madhab of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. In the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are different than Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. In the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are different in Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. In the Qadr faith, they are different from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. In Iman, in Mu'jizat, many of the main pillars or foundation of the creed or the correct faith of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they don't follow the major pillars or major foundation of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So they are not from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. When they came up at that time with Imam Ahmad, like Al-Kullabiyya and his followers, Abdullah ibn Sa'id al-Kullab and Al-Qalanisi and Muhasibi, Imam Ahmad and Ishaq ibn Rahoya, Yahim Ma'in, all of them, they warned the people from their faith, from their sects, from their statements on the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes. So the scholars of Islam like Imam Ahmad and who comes after him, like al-Bukhari, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, Ibn Majah, and who comes after them, like Nasa'i, Daraqutni, Ibn Khuzaymah, all of them, they warned the Muslims from these kind of sects, which is Asha'ira and al-Kullabiyya and al-Maturidiyya. And they told the Muslims they are not following the Kitab and Sunnah. Ahl Sunnah al-Jama'ah, this means the people of the Sunnah, and they are gathering about the Sunnah. How come in their names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're not following the Sunnah, and we say they are from Ahl Sunnah? Ahl Sunnah means the people of Sunnah. They are following the Sunnah. They are putting the Sunnah in ahead of every statement, any topic. They put the Sunnah in front, at the top of everything. But they come up with the statement of Abu Hassan Ash'ari, Abu Mansur Maturidi, they make it upon, in front of the statement of the Quran, or the verse of the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad hadith and the statements of the companions. So they're not from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, even though they are closer than others. If you compare Asha'ira and Maturidiyya, if you compare them with Mu'tazila, they are closer to us. But if you compare them to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they are far away. They're not kuffar for sure. They are from the people of innovation. They are Mubtali'ah. Even though you might find some scholars, big scholars, they are following Asha'ira. But we respect them as long as they have good effort in Islam. But even though we don't say what they say and their faith and their belief is correct, we have to follow Quran and Sunnah and the companions of the Prophet Muhammad Sallam. Every scholar can make a mistake, but we cannot say the Sahaba, they are making mistakes. Quran is not correct, or Sunnah is not correct. So we have to follow the Quran and Sunnah and the statement of the companions. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us in the Quran and the Sunnah.
No. Alhamdulillah, everything was clear. Maybe that was the last question, Shaykhana.
Jazakumullah khair, barakallahu fiik.
Jazakumullah khair. Inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe the next time we will have another session like this, Shaykhana. You will give us
inshallah.
Inshallah.
My language, my English.
Inshallah, inshallah.
I tried my best.
Inshallah. We're also trying our best to speak in English. Lillahi alhamd.
Inshallah.
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 Then نكتفي. إذا نكتفي بهذا القدر. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله بارك الله بارك الله فيك. الله السلام عليكم ورحمة
الله. وعليكم السلام.
ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا وقال إنني من المسلمين.